Recently, a new catch-share fisheries management program was adopted by the multi-species fleet that operates in the federal waters off the coast of Alaska. This is one of the first catch-share programs developed primarily to address conservation and ecosystem management concerns. The program, which ends the Derby-style race for fish and allows for the formation of fishing cooperatives, has exceeded most program goals and resulted in several species receiving sustainable fishery certification by the Marine Stewardship Council. Formed in 2008, the Alaska Seafood Cooperative includes 17 trawl catcher processors that fish the Bering Sea and Aleutian Islands. This fleet represents the largest flatfish fishery in the world, feeding millions of people every year. The fleet has access to over 300,000 metric tons of groundfish annually, but they operate very conservatively, harvesting just a fraction of the allowable biological catch. The original goal for this unique catch share program was simple: to improve retention of all groundfish caught in this multi-species fishery, and to improve utilization of those fish as well. From a fisheries management standpoint, the North Pacific Fisheries Management Council previously believed that retention rates were too low, and they felt that a retention standard was needed. This has become known as the groundfish retention standard, which is monitored at the individual vessel and cooperative level. The best way to help the fleet meet this new retention standard was to replace the Derby-style management system with a new catch-share-based program. The catch-share-based approach to management includes a requirement that every vessel have two federal observers aboard at all times, that sophisticated flow scales be used to measure the harvest on an individual vessel basis, and that each vessel provide a daily report on their harvesting and production activity. The fleet also needed the ability to form cooperatives to collectively manage their activities, maximize their use of the fisheries resource, and reduce bycatch and other compliance problems. These needs gave rise to this conservation-based catch share program. In addition, there is a strict requirement that there be no mixing of the catch from individual hauls, which facilitates accurate observer catch sampling. As you can see, the new catch share based approach has worked. In just 2 short years, the fleet increased its groundfish retention to over 90% of its catch and exceeded the groundfish retention standard set by the council. From the fleet's perspective, the fisheries problem was a direct result of the Derby-style race for fish created by the fisheries management plan. By ending the race for fish and replacing it with cooperatives, there is a new level of individual vessel accountability and responsiveness based on civil contracts rather than rigid federal regulations. The result has been dramatically reduced discards and increased utilization of the fish that are harvested. The cooperative now focuses on maximizing their dollars per fish rather than maximizing the number of fish caught per day. Working with federal scientists, the cooperative has also adopted a collaborative approach to gear development that utilizes fish behavior to reduce the harvest of unwanted fish, often referred to as bycatch. The result has been a significant decrease in the discard of unwanted fish and reduced adverse impacts on the ecosystem itself. This catch share program has stimulated the development of several innovative management measures. For instance, the use of simultaneous target species openings allow the fleet to keep nearly everything it catches. This also means that there is no longer a need for seasonal bycatch allocations, also known as prohibited species catch. The fleet is no longer told which species to fish and where. Instead, they can move to areas containing high abundance of target species and avoid areas where bycatch is a problem. An improved pollock bycatch retention rule was implemented so that these valuable fish can be retained and processed to feed people rather than discarded. And perhaps most importantly, by eliminating the race for fish and giving each vessel a guaranteed share of the total allowable catch, vessels can now move away from high bycatch areas without the fear of losing their share of the harvest. The cooperative can also choose to stand down during periods of high bycatch, and as previously mentioned, there are new collaborative efforts underway to modify gear to reduce the incidental catch of prohibited species. The result of these measures has been immediate and significant. To date, the fleet has not exceeded its allocated quotas and has not been limited by historically constraining bycatch species. Craig Rose, a federal scientist working for the Alaska Fisheries Science Center, explains how the new cooperative-based efforts are making a difference where it matters, in the ocean itself.
It is not a matter of just, sieving ping pong balls out of the water. It is using the behaviors of the fish to move them into the capture net and to hopefully move the animals that you don't want to capture and don't want to damage out away from the capture process.
We used to use these old V doors, they call them, for trawling. Yeah, now we're using what you see out on deck here is a hybrid midwater door.
Now what we've done is experimented with these cables and seen if we can raise them just a little bit off of the seafloor, something that creates a lot less contact with the seafloor and less damage to the animals on the seafloor, will the flatfish still be herded into the path? And we did those tests and found out that yes, as long as approximately 3-inch clearance or so, maybe up to 4, you still get effective herding.
Definitely, if you want the greatest challenge, it's to run a head gutter vessel that fishes for a variety of different fish. We've been the most proactive group, and we've had to be.
This new catch share-based approach to management, the largest flatfish fishery in the world, has replaced the race for fish with a race for efficiency. Vessels fishing under the cooperative structure now require fewer tows to catch the fish they need for seafood production. Vessels can now target areas of high abundance, even if it means traveling greater distances because their share of the catch is guaranteed. As we have shown, the fleet is now retaining more of the fish they catch and better able to avoid the fish they don't want to catch. As a result, several species that are harvested under this Catch Shares program have been recently certified as sustainable by the Marine Stewardship Council. The program has also allowed smaller, less competitive vessels to exit the fisheries with reasonable compensation. For these smaller vessels, the cost of observers and flow scales was simply too high, and the cost of time spent going to and from the fishing grounds was too great. But rather than being forced out through bankruptcy, they were compensated by other cooperative members by selling their fishing rights. The world doesn't stand still. For instance, the Alaska Seafood Cooperative has now turned its collective attention and resources to issues surrounding the management of stellar sea lions within their traditional fishing areas. For more information about the Alaska Seafood Cooperative Catch Share programs and other fisheries management issues, go to alaskaseafoodcooperative.org. That's alaskaseafoodcooperative.org.